Hello, good evening, and welcome to the New York Show, the magazine. I am Ahmed Al-Baqsami. Dr. Dhakir, I would like to welcome you here in the magazine show.
Rabbi shrahli sadri, wa yassir li amri, wa ahlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. It's my pleasure to be with you, brother.
Thank you, brother. And I know this is a verse from Quran, but I want the viewers, can you translate for us those verses that you've just read?
When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, asks Moses, peace be upon him, to deliver the message to Pharaoh, he makes a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Surah Taha, chapter 20, verse 25 to 28, which reads, Rabbi shrahli sadri, that, O my Lord, expand my breast for me, expand my center for me, wa yassir li amri, and make my task easy for me, wa ahlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli, and remove the impediment from my speech. And if there is any barrier, mental or whatever, that's there between me and the audience, and the people understand me.
So this is a kind of dua and supplication that mentioned the Holy Quran, that Muslims, they will say it, that will encourage them to say their speech and say whatever things they want. I think if you also continue, then he asked God the Almighty to put Harun, his helper like this.
That's right, I agree.
Dr. Dhakir, I would like to ask you about the foundation in India, the Islamic Foundation. Can you talk to us a little bit about this?
The Islamic Foundation was started in 1991. It was established to concentrate on the Muslim educated youth who are apologetic about their religion and who have an inferiority complex, who go to engineering college, who go to medical colleges, and who feel that the teachings of Islam are 1400 years old and do not hold good any longer in this age of science and technology. Like a person should not have alcohol, he should not have pork, that a Muslim is allowed to marry more than one wife. So all these teachings are outdated. So we have started the foundation to concentrate on these educated Muslim youth and simultaneously to remove the misconceptions from the minds of the non-Muslims, since the majority of the information that they acquire is from the Western media and the Orientalists. So we have started the foundation to remove the misconceptions from the minds of the non-Muslims.
Since you're talking about different non-Muslims that will talk about Muslims, in the Islamic religion, do the women, they have the rights?
In Islam, men and women have got equal rights. But equality does not mean identicality. They are equal overall, but in some aspects, the men have a degree of advantage. In some aspects, the women have a degree of advantage. But overall, men and women are equal.
How about, like in Islam, they say the man can have four wives. Some will say, why the women? They cannot have four husbands.
There's a logical reason for why a man is allowed to marry more than one wife. But the vice versa is not true, that polyandry, a woman is not allowed to have more than one husband, is because that if a man has more than one wife, and if the child is born, you can very well identify the mother as well as the father of that child. But if a woman has more than one husband, and if a child is born, you can identify the mother, but not the father. And there are various other reasons. For example, that a man is much more polygamous in nature as compared to the woman. And besides that, if a man has more than one life partner, he doesn't have any sexually transmitted diseases. But if a woman has more than one sexual partner, there are high possibilities that she may have STD, that is sexually transmitted disease.
But is there any rules and condition for the man? Does he have to pay them equal, that he has to be with them equally, or he just can marry and neglect the first wife?
And the only condition which the Quran mentions in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 3, which says that marry woman of your choice in twos, threes, or fours. But if you can't do justice, marry only one. So Islam says that you're allowed to marry more than one wife only under the condition that you can do justice. If you can't do justice, you cannot marry more than one wife.
Doctor, can you define justice for us? What is justice?
Justice means, for example, if a Muslim man has got two wives, and if he buys a car for one wife, say maybe a Mercedes car, so for the other wife also, he should buy a Mercedes car. If he buys a flat for one of the wives, which has three bedrooms, so even for the other wife, he should buy a three-bedroom flat. In terms of economic justice, in terms of social justice, in cases of love, etc., in all the fields, as far as possible, the husband should be just between all his wives, if he has more than one wife.
But I mean, if a husband, for instance, as you said, if he cannot do that, for instance, he cannot buy two Mercedes, he only can afford one car.
Okay, what he should do, that he should buy two Toyotas and give one to the first wife and the second to the other wife.
No, I mean, if he cannot afford to have four wives, is it compulsory to have four wives?
nowhere does Islam say that it is compulsory to marry more than one wife. In fact, polygyny, a man having more than one wife, is optional. Nowhere does the hadith say that if you marry more than one wife, you get more sawab. It's optional. But the criteria is that if you marry more than one wife, you should be able to do justice. If you can't do justice, then you will be sinning if you have more than one wife and you can't do justice. And regarding the first part, that a person should not only be rich to marry more than one wife, that if he's poor, then whatever amount of resources that he has, he should equally divide it between both his wives. And resources are not the only criteria, even love, affection, the social conditions, and all the other aspects of life.
We'll talk about intermixed marriages between Islam and other religions. Are the men or women Muslims, they can intermix marriage with other religions?
The Holy Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 221, that do not marry unbelieving women until they believe. That means do not marry mushrik women until they believe. Even a slave woman who is a believer, who is a mu'min, she is much better than a non-Muslim.
Is there any reason behind this?
The thing is that for a married life to be successful, but natural, both the life partners should have the same ideology. You can't have a car running with one tire being that of a cycle and the other of a truck. So but natural, the ideology should be same. That's the reason the life partners, both of them should be Muslims. But there are certain exceptions for Ahl Kitab, etc. That's another topic.
What is the exceptions for Ahl Kitab? The Ahl Kitab, they are people of the book, they're called.
Right. The Holy Quran says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 5, that you are permitted to marry women from the Ahl Kitab. That means a Muslim man can marry a lady from the Ahl Kitab, that is, who is a Jew or a Christian. The reason that the permission has been given is because that all the prophets which the Jews and the Christians believe in, even a Muslim believes in those prophets.
Like Moses for the Jews and Jesus Christ for the...
No, in fact, right from the starting,
yes.
Adam, Noah, Abraham, Solomon, Moses, Jesus, peace be upon them all. We believe in all those prophets. So when they come into the Muslim family, what we request them is that you believe in one additional prophet, that the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
And of course, if you don't believe in those prophets, you're not a Muslim.
That's right. Uh-huh. It's compulsory that a Muslim should believe in all the prophets of Almighty God, right from Adam till Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon them all.
Then, I mean, why the Muslim woman, she cannot marry a Christian or Jew?
The reason that a Muslim woman is not allowed to marry a man who is a Christian or a Jew is because she is going into a new family. In the other case, a woman comes into a Muslim family where all the family members respect all of their prophets. But when the Muslim woman goes into a Jewish family or a Christian family, that family will not respect our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May peace be upon him.
Yes.
So she won't be comfortable. And but natural, they will not accept Islam. That is the reason a Muslim man is allowed to marry a woman from the Ahl Kitab, but the vice versa is not true.
One of the crucial controversy now happening, it's almost in some countries all over the world, it's about hijab. The woman in Islam, she required, it's compulsory to put hijab. What is the reason behind this? Hijab is the cover, the scarf that they cover, they have to dress long, you know, things. And what is the reason behind this?
There are various reasons why hijab is done, but the best answer is given in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 59, which says that, O Prophet, tell your wives and the believing women that when they go abroad, they should put on the cloak. They should wear the cloak, so that they will be recognized and it will prevent them from being molested. One of the reasons, a small reason, there are various reasons, is that, for example, if two twin sisters are walking down the streets of a Western country like America or England, and if one sister, she's wearing the Islamic hijab, her complete body is covered, the only part that can be seen are the face and the hands, and the other twin sister who's equally beautiful, she's wearing the skirt or the mini. If both of them are walking down the streets, and if round the corner there is a hooligan,